to begin this morning by expressing gratitude to Father Bill Stanford and the people of St. Christopher's for your hospitality. We're very grateful to be here with you this morning, and I would also like to introduce and welcome our guests. First, Kathy Comer, our storyteller from the Diocese of Texas. Is Bob Ray here?
He will be this afternoon.
He'll be here later this afternoon. Okay. I would like to introduce Michael Hun, who is the canon for ministry within the Episcopal Church. They're all on the front row here. Sharon Jones, who is the executive coordinator for the presiding bishop, and Tara Holly, who is the director of development, and of course our presiding bishop, Michael Curry. Now the theme for the presiding bishop's visit to the Diocese of Fort Worth this week is I love to tell the story. And it is obvious by her telling of the story that from John's Gospel today that Kathy Comer loves to tell the story. Later today we will do some work around our story and storytelling. So this morning I would like to take just a moment to tell a recent slice of my own story. Approximately 2 years ago, the standing committees from the Diocese of Fort Worth and the Diocese of Northwest Texas met in Abilene to discern how these two dioceses could share resources, specifically the resource called Bishop. The event was called the Abilene Summit, quite an impressive event title. And it came to pass that I was elected to serve as your bishop provisional, and officially I began service on July the 1st while at General Convention. You may remember that convention, Bishop Curry. It was in Salt Lake City. Well, in an introductory letter to the diocese, I wrote, in effect, that I did not believe that we are called to rebuild the old church, and that I did not think that resuscitation was our goal. Yes, Lazarus was happy with resuscitation, and Jesus was as well, and I'll take resuscitation if I'm honest. But I said resurrection is something else. It's something different. Resurrection is not the restoration of life as the same old body. In this new day, we are called to participate in resurrection to new life as a new body. And you've all heard me say this, so this is just a brief review to set the context of this slice of my story. At any rate, I could write that letter, that initial letter to you, regarding resurrection with some level of authority. In other words, in my past, I have seen such resurrections. To paraphrase Mark Twain in regards to the question of infant baptism, I don't have to believe in it, I've seen it. I've seen individual persons resurrected to new life as different persons, as we may say. I've seen congregations resurrected to new life as a new body. And I've had the occasion to participate in that. So in a sense, I can say these particular things with authority. It's like in Matthew's gospel, when Jesus concluded the Sermon on the Mount, it's three chapters long, if you've got the red letter Bible, as I know all Episcopalians do, especially the clergy, you got that three chapters long, and Matthew then concludes that with the black letters. Now, when Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority, and not as their scribes. In other words, Jesus is speaking out of his personal knowledge and experience. In the Greek, it means Jesus is speaking out of his being. Unlike the scribes, who are known to repeat what others have said or written, or quote one another, Jesus speaks out of his own personal knowledge and experience, out of his being. Jesus is speaking with authority, not simply repeating something he read in a book, not speaking what the answer is on the test, but speaking out of his life Authority in that sense is something he lived. When I wrote that initial introductory letter, I didn't write anything most of you didn't know already, or for that matter, hadn't already lived. And you can speak with the same authority. But another significant, to me anyway, it's significant slice of my story has happened since the time I've been called to serve you. That's not uncommon as a bishop or as anyone who serves on a diocesan staff that serves multiple congregations to see on occasion congregations who are in survival mode. It's probably true for dioceses. For whatever reason, something has happened in the life of the congregation, and it can be something instant and dramatic. It can be like the frog in the kettle of slowly boiling water. It can be the changing neighborhood demographic. It can be the result of the end of Christendom, which is long gone. Something has happened in the history of the congregation, and for whatever reason, the congregation has seen a decline in membership and budget, and so the congregation has become inwardly focused on survival. And oftentimes for congregations in survival mode, the purpose of evangelism actually becomes restoring membership and budget so we can keep doing business as usual. And outreach becomes a line item on the budget determined after the line items regarding maintenance and property. It's an understandable posture, trying to survive. Trying to survive is understandable. And I feel for these congregations and I grieve with them. And for a long time, I've known the answer. I've known the way to break out of survival mode and start living. I know the way is to make the shift from our inward focus to an outward focus. That's the answer, and I've known that in theory. I've known it as the right answer on the test. I could pass the seminary class on missiology. And certainly I have witnessed small West Texas congregations resist the initial temptation to turn inward and rather choose to live rather than survive. But I've never had occasion to experience what I've experienced with you. You made choices over 8 years ago to be mission focused. You could have entrenched yourselves. You could have held steady until the judge ruled. But from day one, you chose living over survival and love over fear. For example, you paid your full asking to the Episcopal Church before you paid another bill. You budgeted your fair share to support such institutions as seminaries. Congregations with little in the way of financial resources looked beyond themselves to their respective neighborhoods. Deacons took seriously their vow to interpret to the church the needs, concerns, and hopes of the world. And you responded. And you are alive. And you can speak with authority. And because of you, I know the answer to the challenge of decline, not as a theory, not as the right answer on the test, but as something I know. Something I can speak about with authority, and not simply a platitude. I don't have to believe it. I've seen it. So that's a recent slice of my story. Not to be melodramatic, but you have changed a bishop's life, at least some. And you're leading the Episcopal Church. You don't have to believe it. You're seeing it. God does indeed, as we say in the Easter acclamation, God does raise the dead.